Recorded Books is pleased to present the Modern Scholar series, where great professors teach you. My name is Richard Poe, and I'll be your host. Today we begin a course entitled The Hebrew Bible. Your professor is Lawrence H. Schiffman, chairman of New York University's Skirball Department of Hebrew and Judaic Studies. He is also a member of the university's Centers for Ancient Studies and Near Eastern Studies. He is a past president of the Association for Jewish Studies. He currently serves as editor-in-chief of the Center for Online Judaic Studies in New York. Professor Schiffman was featured in the PBS Nova television series documentary Secrets of the Dead Sea Scrolls, as well as in 4 BBC documentaries on the scrolls, the McNeil-Lehrer program, and the Discovery Special. The author of numerous books, his most recent publication is Texts and Traditions, a source reader for the study of Second Temple and Rabbinic Judaism. For more information on this course, please visit its webpage at www.modernscholar.com, where you'll have access to links to related sites, a seminar room to share your thoughts with other students, and yes, of course, a final exam. And now we begin The Hebrew Bible, Lecture 1. The Bible, Hebrew Scriptures, and the Old Testament. The Nature of the Collection. And now, Professor Schiffman.
We're going to be talking about a set of texts that has had really unbelievable impact on our Western civilization. In fact, it lies at the basis of Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, the great religious traditions that have really molded the civilization and culture in which we live today. Now, this thing is often called the Bible, but in reality, we are going to be talking about one of the parts of what at least the Christians call the Bible, that part called simply the Bible by the Jews, known also as the Old Testament by the Christians, and also referred to by scholars as the Hebrew Scriptures. And there are even more names that we have to talk about. What we want to do in this first lecture is to simultaneously outline some of the contents of this collection, but initially to come to an understanding of its nature by looking at the various names that it's been given, and thereby also to understand something of its impact on our culture. Now, most people realize that the very first books of what we call the Bible are the 5 books of Moses. These are often referred to by their Hebrew name, the Torah, or by a name that derives from Greek, Pentateuch. Let's begin by looking at these names and what they mean. Torah, originally, is a term for a specific body of law. For example, one will find in Numbers, this is the law, Hebrew Torah, if one dies in a tent. And what happens, therefore, if a dead body is in a tent? And that is an introduction to the set of laws regarding ritual purity and impurity caused by a dead body. Now, the point is that there the word Torah simply means a set of laws on one topic. By the time the Torah as a whole was collected, by the Persian period, which begins in 540 BCE, there was a sense that the Torah included 5 books, and that all those 5 books, which were attributed somehow or another to Moses, or at least transmitted from Moses, constituted a whole. Now, this whole, called in Hebrew Torah, also was called later on by the term Pentateuch, meaning the 5 books. Now, when we look at the word Torah, we learn something else very important about the books of the 5 books of Moses, and also about the Bible in general. Because the root of the word Torah is a root which means basically to teach. But behind that root is an earlier meaning, a meaning of to shoot. And the reason is because a teacher shows someone in what direction to shoot. And basically, we could therefore understand the word Torah to mean direction. And we come to an understanding that the 5 books of Moses and the rest of the Bible to a great extent, are meant to direct the lives of human beings. Now, this term, Torah or Pentateuch, only applies to the first five books of Scripture. But the wider term, Bible, for the Jews, encompassed a Bible made up of three separate collections, each of which we will talk about in a moment. Now, when we use that word Bible, we're using a term that derives from Greek, ta biblia. It refers to the fact that the Bible, as we know it, is especially a collection of the books. That's what it means, the books. And this refers to a set of authoritative books. And here we have another special term. We refer to the authoritative books as the canon, those books which are part of the official collection. Now, for the Hebrew Scriptures, or Hebrew Bible, the canon was divided into three parts. Jews, therefore, had another name for this collection. That name is Tanakh. Tanakh is an acronym for Torah, the first five books of Moses, Nevi'im, the prophets, and Ketuvim, the writings. All of these three sections together are what was called the Bible, or for Jews, the Tanakh. Now, these three sections, the first, of course, is simply the five books of Moses. The second of the prophets includes first the historical books, Joshua, Judges, Samuel, and Kings. And then it continues with what we call the literary prophets. That is to say, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, and the so-called 12 minor prophets, which are not minor because they are unimportant, but they're only minor because they mean smaller prophets. These prophets had to be put into one scroll because they were too small and would otherwise be lost. But actually, they're not unimportant, they're just smaller. In any case, that's the second section, the prophets. The third prophets, the writings, contained the books of Psalms, as well as Proverbs and Job. Then the five scrolls, and following that, the books of Ezra, Nehemiah, and Chronicles, additional historical books. This three-part canon, or we might call it in fancy language, tripartite canon, constituted the Hebrew Scriptures as they are known to the Jews and as they function within Judaism. Now, Christians have a completely different term for this. Because Christians, in addition to this material that I've mentioned so far, have an additional set of texts which constitute the New Testament, namely the Gospels and the Epistles, Christians referred to the earlier materials as the Old Testament, in contradistinction, of course, to the New. But this is, in fact, a theologically loaded term. Let me explain. The term New Testament is basically adopted from the Christian interpretation of the idea of the new covenant mentioned in Jeremiah. Now, Jeremiah's new covenant meant for the Jews a reconstituted and renewed covenant. But for Christians, it meant a new covenant that came into being at the coming of Jesus. In early Christianity, this meant that the Jewish covenant was canceled and that basically God now had only the new covenant. And hence, aspects of the Old Testament were obsolete. This view is termed supersessionism, the idea that Christianity superseded Judaism. In recent years, in our own time, especially after the Holocaust, the Catholic Church and other Christian denominations have backed away from this theology, believing that the covenant with the Jews remains for them, and that the covenant, essentially, of Christianity, that of the New Testament, is for the rest of the world. However, the point that I want to make here is that the term New Testament led to the term Old Testament for the earlier books, and this was a term which basically indicated the obsolescence of at least the part of it termed the law, that is to say the ritual or ceremonial law. Because of the fact that this term is therefore a loaded term which indicates a Christian theological motif, scholars have begun to use instead Hebrew Scriptures. Now, this term itself recalls some interesting things, because scriptures refers to the fact that the books of the Bible are often referred to as that which is written. However, the Hebrew term mikra, meaning that which is read, has become very popular, being used almost as much as the term Tanakh in Hebrew, indicating the tripartite canon. So to quickly review, we can call it the Bible if we're using the term Bible in Jewish terms. The Christian term Old Testament was very popular, but is now being supplanted in academic and intellectual circles by Hebrew scriptures. Whatever we call it, it's for Jews the whole Bible, for Christians the first half of the Bible, and that's the collection that we'll be talking about in this series of lectures. For Jews, this collection is divided into three parts: the Torah, the prophets, and the writings. But that designation is not the designation used by Christians for reasons which we will now explain. The Bible as it exists in the hands of the Jews is essentially the Bible as it was collected in ancient days in the land of Israel over a long period of time. We think that the Torah was collected by the Persian period of 540 BCE, when it appears as a unity. The prophets were collected at least before the time of Daniel, because he was apparently too late living in the Second Temple period. So let's assume that the prophets were collected during the Babylonian exile, which took place after the temple was destroyed in 586 BCE. And the writings were for the most part collected by the Second Temple period, but we find that there is still some debate about the writings in the first century CE. The writings are referred to in the New Testament as the rest of the books. Apparently, this was still an open collection. Now, this collection of those books canonized, collected, and understood to be authoritative by Jews in the land of Israel became the Bible for the Jews. The situation was a little bit different for Christians. There, the story goes like this. The Bible was also collected in an authoritative collection by Jews in Alexandria. Beginning in the 240s BCE, the books of the Torah, or Pentateuch, the five books of Moses, were translated into Greek. This is called the Septuagint. As time continued, various other biblical books were translated into Greek, so that by the time of the New Testament, the entire Hebrew scriptures was available in Greek, and in fact, both the New Testament and the Jewish historian Josephus, who died in around the year 100 CE, used this Greek Bible as a basis for their work. The Greek Bible collected the scriptures and ordered them in a different way. First of all, it ordered the books according to genre, so that historical books were all together. So, for example, Chronicles was after Kings. So it didn't have the order of the three parts that the Jews were used to. But it also interfiled among the books that were in the Jewish collection additional books, which we know of as the Apocrypha. These books are considered to be canonical, that is to say authoritative, for the Roman Catholic Church, and some of them are authoritative in various Eastern churches. However, these books were considered by the Protestant Reformation not to really belong to the Bible, and hence Protestant Bibles preserve the Bible in the Catholic order, which is really the order of the Greek Bibles, but leave out the Apocrypha. Jewish Bibles continue to preserve the Bible in the order of the three parts, Torah, prophets, and writings. So you basically have three different kinds of Bible collections. The Jewish collection of the books from the land of Israel, which is in the order of the three parts, Torah, prophets, writings. The Catholic collection, which is in the order of genre, and which includes some later books from the Second Temple period, which are collected there as the Apocrypha. And finally, the Protestant group of texts, which runs in the same order of the Catholic texts based on the Greek, but leaves out those books not in the Jewish Bible. Now, this situation has led to one very humorous result. The books of 1 and 2 Maccabees, which describe the story of Hanukkah, are part of the Catholic Bibles, but not part of the Jewish Bible. This is sort of like the reverse. Imagine if the Christmas story was told in the Jewish Bibles, but not in the Christian Bibles. It is, I think, sort of a great irony. But this is because these books and other books from the Hellenistic period, the years after Alexander the Great, that is to say after 334 BCE, are included in these Greek Bibles that are used as the basis for the Catholic Latin Bible, but they're not, as I mentioned, in the Protestant or Jewish Bibles. You can already see that the terms that we use to describe the Bible are definitely theological terms which are used by the various faith communities. We're going to be trying in this series of lectures to avoid the presumptions of faith communities and ask questions from an academic scholarly point of view. However, as we do so, we will also mention and respect the views of the faith communities. These views go back to very, very long traditions, and if one admits the truth, we will realize that often it is only the tradition of the faith communities that even tells us what certain biblical words mean. If we search in the ancient translations, whether Greek, Latin, or Aramaic, or if we look at traditional medieval commentators, Jewish or Christian, to find out the meaning of a verse, we will be dependent on those communities who pass down Scripture as a living tradition. And therefore, it should not surprise us that the titles that they use for the collections of Scripture, indeed the ones that we follow them in using, and our modern terms, all indicate something about the theology behind it. Now we have to say a little bit about the nature of the historical background of the period from which these texts come. The biblical period is essentially the years of the great civilization of ancient Israel, which was one of the civilizations of the ancient Near East. Now, this spans parts of the Bronze Age and the Iron Age, and even comes practically up into the Hellenistic era. We're speaking about a period that begins sometime around 1800 BCE, when we assume that the patriarchs would have lived, and continues all the way up through the end of the biblical storyline, which is about 400 BCE. But at the same time, it's possible that the latest of the biblical books was written in the 2nd century BCE, which is already the Hellenistic period. So we span a very, very long period. Let's review some of the events that took place during that period. The patriarchs would have lived sometime between 1800 BCE and somewhere around 1500 BCE. Depending on when one dates it, the Exodus might have occurred in the 16th century BCE, or it may have occurred as late as 450 BCE. Now, it looks like the years afterwards, about 1250 to 1200, would have been the period in which the Israelites wandered in the desert. And then they would have entered into the land of Canaan in about 1200 BCE, leaving 1200 to 1000 for the period of the conquest and the judges. It's at that time that we would enter into the years of the united monarchy of Kings Saul, David, and Solomon. The united monarchy would soon fall apart, and by, depending on whose dates you want to take, about 950 or 930 BCE, the monarchy would be split into the southern tribes of Judah and the northern people of Israel. It's during this time that the great prophets came to the fore. For example, in the 8th century, Amos, Hosea, Isaiah, and Micah. We will be speaking in later lectures about the dating of the Torah and some of these other books. But the process of the writing and collection of Israelite tradition continues through this period in which the tribes are divided. Now, in 722 BCE, the Assyrians destroyed the northern kingdom, bringing to an end the literary creativity of that kingdom, which gave us some of the books of the prophets. But the process of literary composition and the independence of Judah continued until we arrived at 597, when Jerusalem was captured by Nebuchadnezzar and some Jews were deported to Babylon. After the Jews again revolted in 586 BCE, Jerusalem was destroyed, the temple was destroyed, and the people were exiled, or at least some were exiled, off into Babylonia. One should remember that the first exile of 722 under Assyria and the later exile under Babylonia still left the vast majority of the people in the land of Israel. Now, the Babylonian Empire soon fell, and by 540 BCE, the Persian Empire ruled over most of the ancient world. At that point, many nations were allowed to reconstitute themselves, and the people of Israel was allowed to return from Babylonian exile to its ancient home. This is the period first of the rebuilding of the temple and of the prophets Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi, and then a bit later, the period of Ezra and Nehemiah. This was the era in which the second temple was constituted, and basically Judea, known then as Yehud, was a small area around Jerusalem with some quasi-independence under the Persian Empire. But this was a period in which there begins to be a turn from what is termed by many scholars Israelite religion, that is to say the religion of the Bible, to that of Judaism as we know it. Because it's in this period that many of the biblical traditions begin to evolve into the Judaism that we find later on in Second Temple and what we call rabbinic times, the era of the early centuries CE, when the Mishnah and Talmud were being developed in Judaism. So what we see here is that what we will term the period of the Hebrew Scriptures is a long period running, as we said, from sometime in the second millennium BCE up to, effectively, the coming of the Greeks, and maybe from a literary point of view into that period. This means that the Bible is not going to have been written in a vacuum. We need to expect that this classic of Israelite religion and literature is going to have been influenced in certain ways by the environment around. Modern biblical scholarship has been to a great extent fueled by the discovery of information about those civilizations, whether it is ancient Egypt or ancient Mesopotamia or ancient Canaan, where especially in the north, the site called Ras Shamra, ancient Ugarit, has yielded many very important texts. What we find is the more that we learn about these civilizations, the more we can understand the background of the Bible. So, for example, when we look at ancient Mesopotamia, we find law codes that in certain ways parallel those of the Bible. We find stories of creation and even a flood story similar to that of the Bible. We find many of the biblical names in use in some of these other civilizations. When we continue to look at Egyptian civilization, we come to an understanding of those things that somehow or another formed biblical civilization by providing a kind of oppositional tradition. In many ways, the Bible wanted, for example, to avoid a cult of the dead because Egyptian religion was so concentrated on the dead. Israelite religion was very much linked to the cycle of the rainy seasons and dry seasons, as opposed to Egyptian religion that was linked to the kind of unending, inexorable cycle of the Nile. When we look at the traditions of ancient Canaan, we're able to find also certain religious traditions against which the Israelites apparently revolted. We are able to find religious traditions which the Israelites greatly rejected. But at the same time, when we look at the poetry and we look at some of the ritual specifications in the Canaanite text from Ugarit, we find an amazing resemblance to the biblical tradition. When we trace the history of the kingdom, first of the United Kingdom and then the divided kingdom, we see that it was dependent to a great extent on the ups and downs of the surrounding kingdoms. When Egypt or Mesopotamia sought to rule over the land of Israel, whatever was the Israelite state at that time was weakened because of the pressure from outside. But when the Egyptians and the Mesopotamian rulers were at each other's throats, in those eras, we find that the Jewish or Israelite state is able to expand. So essentially what we have here is a combination of historical factors with the inner creativity of the people of Israel that produces the environment in which the Bible is going to be created, and which also makes possible the Bible's reaction to the civilization all around. This is very important because it indicates that in its own day, the Bible was not a document or set of documents divorced from reality, but rather it was a text that sought to grapple with the reality of the times. Now we have to mention two terms which I have been using almost interchangeably, which have been under some considerable discussion in scholarly literature. And these are the terms Israelite and Jewish. Now, on the face of it, scholars will tell you that these terms are used as follows. Israelite is a term for the ancient people of Israel and their traditions, that is to say, those which existed during the First Temple period and even up to the beginning of Second Temple times, before we begin to use the word Jewish to constitute a transfer both from the religion of ancient Israel to what we call Judaism, and also a transfer from a concept of Israel as a land-based people to Israel as a kind of portable religious group, able to move around to different places within a wider diaspora. Now, these indeed are the usages, as we will encounter them, in most scholarly discourse. At the same time, I should point out that this usage goes back to a New Testament usage. In the New Testament usage, the ancient people is called Israel, whereas those who are presumed to have gone astray by not accepting Jesus are the Jews. This particular use of these designations influenced early scholarship, and so sometimes one finds the use of Israelite to refer to the pristine biblical tradition, and then one finds instead the term Jewish being used for what is assumed to be a corrupted post-Hebrew Bible tradition that seems to have lost its way. Now, of course, this is a relic of an older point of view, again, of that same approach, the notion that the New Testament supersedes the Old and that Christianity supersedes rather than incorporates Judaism. I have to admit that I will use these terms often in an interchangeable way. I also have to admit that some scholars don't like that. Some scholars want to be purists in maintaining this distinction. My problem, and I want to explain this in some detail, is that I'm not totally certain that the difference holds water. Essentially, there is an evolution of the religion of the Bible that takes place throughout the biblical period. God moves from being the private personal God of the patriarchs to being the God of a nation. When we reach the prophets, the international and cosmic nature of God is being emphasized. And once we reach the writings, The nature of his internationalism is emphasized because Israel is living in a much bigger world. And I think, therefore, that it is fair to state that there is constant transition in the nature of this religion throughout the period of the Hebrew Scriptures. And I don't know why that transition should be assumed to be less than the transition that is made in entering the Persian period or entering the Hellenistic or even Roman periods. It seems to me that there is no specific place where we can draw the line between a kind of biblical religion and a kind of post-biblical religion. These terms are handy, post-biblical, post-Hebrew Bible. They're handy terms. But the truth be told, what we today call Judaism was derived from the biblical tradition and develops within it, essentially as its major interpretation. And whether we call it Israelite or Jewish, it seems to be evolving fundamentally in a very similar direction. And in fact, the Jewish influence on Christianity is not the influence of some kind of pristine Bible, but as we know today, the ethical system of early Christianity is itself derived from that of the Pharisees and early Talmudic rabbis. And numerous commentaries on the New Testament have shown over and over not only the influence of Second Temple sources like the Dead Sea Scrolls, but also the influence of rabbinic texts. So I think it is fair to state that there is really no difference between Israelite and Jewish from this point of view. Although, as I said, I have to admit that many scholars would make that distinction and hold to it throughout. Now, there's one last aspect that I want to discuss in this lecture, and that is the question of what we mean when we speak about approaching the Bible in an academic manner and attempting to do so objectively. One of the problems that we always have is that the primary interpreters of the Bible throughout history have been the faith communities of Judaism and Christianity. The biblical interpretations which they have provided are really the hallmark of any study of the Bible. But in modern times, we have gained a whole bunch of other disciplinary aids. We have archaeology, to which we will devote an entire lecture. We also have the use of literary criticism, a technique that developed starting already in the 1700s, which has led to other kinds of understandings of the inner history of some of the biblical books. We also have certain aspects of the disciplines of religious studies, which have helped us as well. And so when we come to the Bible, we come to the Bible with tools that our ancestors never had. At the same time, there is a whole other aspect which has influenced us. Beginning with the rise of what we generally term the European Enlightenment, and especially in the 19th century, there was tremendous emphasis on the power of humans on their own, with their brain power, you might say, to come to advanced understandings that would help us to develop in all of the sciences. The assumption here, as it was then put, was that man, and that's how they called it in those days, was the measure of all things. And therefore, that with our own abilities, we could understand things that others had understood only based on tradition or based on what they had been told. Now, of course, this was a tremendous boon to science, but in the study of religion, it led to attempts to study religion objectively and to divorce the religious materials from the views of the believers. We are going to try as much as possible in this set of lectures to follow such an approach. We will be considering various points of view. We will not be limited to any one particular approach. We will draw on methods of archaeology, literary criticism, and the tremendously expanded understanding we have of the ancient Near East. And all of this should allow us to sketch out a picture of the Bible and of the issues which we need to be discussing when we speak specifically about the Hebrew Scriptures, which could not be sketched in, say, the Middle Ages. So this gives us a kind of new challenge. Many of you listening to these tapes will be believers in one or another way, and you will have to listen to the conclusions of research and try somehow or another to fit those together with your own approach. I would argue that this is a very beneficial way to study the Bible, first allowing it to speak for itself in at least as objective a manner as possible, and then to try and understand it within the context of our own beliefs and predilections. So I hope that this will be a worthwhile introduction to you to many of the issues which are discussed in the academic study of the Bible.
This ends Lecture 1. The Hebrew Bible, Lecture 2. Who wrote the Bible?
In this lecture, we're going to try and understand some of the questions regarding who wrote the Bible, as well as trying to delve a bit into the authors and editors, and then into the way they pass down the biblical texts which have come down to us. Now, the problem here is that all too often we hear simplistic discussions of questions like, who wrote the Bible? And from this, one is supposed to assume that there's going to be some kind of a short answer. The problem is that we have to break down some of this terminology. First of all, when we speak about the Bible, we're speaking about a collection. We've already mentioned this in the previous lecture to some extent, but I want to emphasize it a bit. If we take a look at this collection, it has materials in it, some of which purport to come from as early as 1200 BCE, and some of which come from apparently as late as the 2nd century BCE. Now, this means to say that we are dealing here with an anthology of materials that constitute a great part of the cultural heritage and religious heritage of the ancient people of Israel. But it's not the whole thing. It's really interesting that there are some 22 books mentioned in the Bible that do not survive. Books like the Book of the Wars of the Lord, and books like the Book of the Chronicles of the Kings of Judah, or the Book of the Chronicles of the Kings of Israel. Do you realize how unbelievable it would be if we had these books that are actually mentioned in various places in the Bible, and if we could look up the references that they make? But in any case, we have an anthology, the Bible, which is not the whole thing. And by the way, it's interesting to note that sometimes people say about the Bible, well, the Bible is the only evidence for X, Y, or Z. You should be aware that the Bible, however, is not one piece of evidence. Because if you have something which is alluded to in the Torah, say for the sake of argument, in the book of Deuteronomy, and then in Samuel, and then in Psalms, and then in another version of the Samuel story in Chronicles, you basically have three accounts rather than one. So we should remember this notion that the Bible is an anthology. And in speaking about who wrote it, we're really speaking about who wrote a whole long list of works. Now, besides that, the matter is even more complicated, because in many cases, the so-called book is a group of disparate materials that have been gathered together to constitute an overall book. Now, when you see this type of thing, you can tell that what has happened is that someone has gathered the materials together, and then often that someone has edited the materials. Let's take, for example, the stories in the book of Judges. It seems that we have a whole bunch of separate stories about various biblical characters. These stories have been gathered together. When we take, for example, the story of Deborah, we even have two versions right there, a prose version and a poetic version. And these stories have been gathered together by somebody who has come along with a certain editorial theory, which we call Deuteronomic, that is to say, the ideology of the book of Deuteronomy. And this editor has edited the work. So very often what we have in a biblical book is a collection of materials that came about somehow, and this collection of materials then is handed over to somebody who brings it together and who may or may not provide an overall editorial framework for the book, which brings all of its disparate parts together, causing them to revolve around a theme or historical order. Now, sometimes this process is much more complex. Sometimes a variety of scribes may have had a role in the process. And in fact, for the book of Jeremiah, we have the role of his scribe Baruch actually described in the Bible itself. In fact, in Jeremiah, we can even see that there were proto-forms of the book and that there were earlier versions which did not contain as many prophecies as later prophecies, as later versions. Further, we also have, in the example of Jeremiah, from the Greek and Hebrew books, and then from the Dead Sea Scrolls, actual proof that Jeremiah circulated in two different literary editions in antiquity, probably resulting from the fact that different editions had existed as early as the time of the prophet himself. So in order to create this thing called the Bible, there's a whole bunch of series of processes, beginning first with composition of the disparate parts, then the disparate parts being brought together in a book and having some kind of editorial, we call it redactional process, which results in the book as a whole. Then the book being brought together into what you might call kind of proto-collections, that is to say collections of books which have religious authority but which may not constitute the entire, what we call the Bible. Then we have that entire Bible being brought together at some point in some kind of complex traditional system in which there eventually developed a consensus among all of those involved, sages, people, priests, which led to a uniform biblical canon, a uniform collection. The reason that this is so important is because it allows us to understand a very, very important feature of the Bible. The Bible speaks in manifold voices. Let's just take one simple example. At the very beginning of the Bible, we have the creation story. In the creation story that appears first in Genesis, man and woman are created simultaneously, and they are created by the divine word. The second creation story in Genesis appears to be a bit closer to the creation stories of the ancient Near East. Here, God is a bit more closely involved in creation. You might say getting his hands dirty, actually breathing the life into the human being. And here, women are created not at the same time as men, but in order to be helpers to solve the problem of man being alone. Now, when one looks at these two stories, one could say, what's going on here? Either one story is true or the other. Why does the Bible have two stories? But it's necessary to understand that that's how the Bible talks. A much later example, which found its way into the Jewish liturgy, and which is also paralleled in the book of Revelation, is the contradiction between the notion that God is removed from the world and that he is also within this world. We have a kind of transcendent God in the statement of Isaiah, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, the whole earth is filled with his glory. We have an immanent God, which is in the verse from Isaiah, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, the whole world is full of his glory. But we have a transcendent God in Ezekiel, where after the description of Ezekiel's vision of the divine throne, we hear, blessed be God from his place, that is to say, from his hidden, separated place from the world. One could ask, which is the real God? Again, the Bible speaks in multiple voices. The message of the Bible is often to give varying points of view, all of which constitute aspects of the way in which the life of humans proceeds and the ways in which humans perceive and understand God. This method of speech in which contradictory materials have been added together into the Holy Scriptures, is something that on the one hand causes some people tremendous difficulty, but on the other hand typifies the way in which the Bible communicates throughout the ages, and certainly serves as a stimulus for it to collect the ancient traditions and history of Israel, even when sometimes those traditions and histories are not totally self-consistent. But this imposes a very special job on the biblical reader and the biblical interpreter. It argues against a kind of simplistic fundamentalism in which the Bible is simply read as if everything it says has to be understood as literally true. And it argues rather for interpretation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.